Oh, I'm so excited. Thank you. This really and truly is a dream come true. And today is not only a very big day for me, but also for the classical guitar. And I say onwards and upwards.
I'd never heard the way that he uses, as it were, like the piano, the left hand to do harmony and the right hand to do the melody. And I just thought it was quite extraordinary.
A great talent. He has worked very hard. And he's lucky to be so good looking. That helps as well.
I always think the relationship between a stringed instrument and our heart strings. There's a reason the phrase hard strings comes from that.
He's got star quality, and star quality not in a superficial way, but that he plays and you must listen.
I was born on the day of the Eurovision Song Contest. And it was a huge one for our country because the representative was from Montenegro, and then it was a big Yugoslavia. So I was brought to the world with people singing, and that's what my mother always jokes about, is that I was always going to be some kind of a singer or something. The person who really inspired me the most, in a way, was my grandmother. She had the most beautiful voice, and every day she would come to help my mother and take care of me and my brother. She would always come with a different song, and she would always sing this most beautiful song with the most amazing voice. And then I would sing on my own, and I would find songs to sing. And it was very easy for me to sing. I never had to think about it, the voice would just happen. It was very good. When I was 8 years old, it was the time when you start the music school. And I went there and they were checking how talented I was, and they decided to give me to play either piano or violin. And I said, how about that I play a guitar? Because we had a guitar that nobody used anymore. I so remember the moment when my father gave me this guitar, because it was sitting on the top of the cupboard in the bedroom, so he had to take a little ladder to get it down. So he got it down, he gave it to me, and I took it. And I really, it is one of the earliest memories of me and the guitar, maybe the very first one, was me picking up this guitar, making a turn around the house, doing the rock star move, and saying, wow, this is very cool. That's what I want to do. When I did pick up the guitar, like every single kid out there, I wanted to be a rock star. And that is that's what everyone does. And then I went to the school and they were really weird. They were like trying to teach me to read music and learn how to play from the sheet and how to, I don't know, use my fingers properly, how to grow nails on every finger so that I can use each finger separately. And for me, this was so boring. I was like, I don't want to do this. I'm like, I had no patience for that. I wanted to strum a few chords, sing a few songs, be popular. I couldn't play football, so it was my niche to play guitar, to sing, you know. And I thought that way I will be much more popular than any of the boys who play football, because all the girls, they love the boys who play the guitar, right? I almost gave up. I said, I'm not going to do this, this is boring. My father felt it was a shame, because the teacher said that I had a very good talent. So he found an old LP of Segovia playing Spanish repertoire. And he invited me into the room one day and he said, I want to show you something. He put this thing on. The sound of Asturias came in. Sound that I had heard until that point. And I couldn't believe that this is something that you can do with one guitar and two hands. And from that moment on, I started to practice a lot. And I started to feel that it is so much more special to be able to create this pure magic with your fingers.
I remember when I was a student that people always said that guitar is the most difficult instrument to play well. And as I've watched people major in guitar and really work on the instrument, you discover just how challenging it is to produce the colors, to master some of the repertoire, and also to build careers on the instrument. And yet it's the one universal instrument that we love no matter what style of music it is.
Spain is connected to the guitar the same as, I don't know, cloud is to the sky. It is the first time for me to come to Granada. It has always been my biggest dream to come here because this is where the strongest traditions exist. Granada for guitarists is like Mecca, because this is the land of the guitar. That's where it all began, and this is where the strongest traditions exist.
Alzapúa, alzapúa is combining is heat with thumb.
Uh-huh. Yes.
Thumb hit down.
Ah. One of the main things which I always wanted to challenge myself with was to take a couple of months and come here and study with a flamenco teacher and to learn to play flamenco, because it is a very, very different style of guitar playing. It is very free. It is completely uninhibited. Bom, bom. It's very exciting to be able to hit the wood. Eh? The aesthetic of the sound is the first thing which is very, very different. Because the sound aesthetic on the classical, we always aim to produce the most beautiful sound, the most clean sound, the most sophisticated interpretation of a piece.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that sometimes we are very limited by this. So mm-hmm. when, for example, I would never do this. If I play this in a concert, they would be like, woo! Because it's not in the style. It's a very different aesthetic.
Mm-hmm.
But in the flamenco, this is actually... It's actually part of the style to have the all of this kind of stuff. Rafa, how many guitars do you make a year?
Bona 14.
And how different are all of them to you? How different does every guitar turn out? Do you have a way to make a guitar very closely similar to each other, or is every guitar like a different person?
Bueno, se hace, cada uno tiene una idea. Entonces, dentro de tú lo que crees que es lo mejor, trabajas y haces una guitarra, pero jamás salen dos guitarras iguales. Como los niños. Los niños pueden ser mellizos. Iguales, físicamente iguales, pero cada uno tiene su personalidad, cada uno es distinto.
Yes.
los propios hijos nuestros, por cada uno distinto. Mm-hmm. Siendo los padres iguales y todos iguales, pero sí. Mm-hmm. Pues eso pasa con la guitarra.
Sí.
Nunca se puede hacer dos guitarras iguales.
Do you play?
No, que
no.
No.
I think guitar makers and instrument makers, they are like alchemists because they create something which is alive and very organic out of something which is very material.
Latino Gold, a special edition of the hit album with 8 new tracks, including The Girl from Ipanema and a stunning new version of Bolero. Milos, Latino Gold, out now.
When I left for London, it completely changed the dynamic in my family because suddenly it's not 4 of us, suddenly it's 3 of them there, and I'm in London. And in 99, 2000, the time when I was leaving, this was science fiction to go to London from here, because we just came out of the most horrible time in history of our country.
Hello, my name is Milos Karadaglic. I'm 16 years old, and I'm from Montenegro. On this tape, you'll hear 5 compositions I've chosen.
For me, up to that point, that audition tape was the most important moment in my life because I was sending this tape to the Royal Academy of Music, and that was my biggest dream and something I wanted so badly. I did it while my parents are at work and they knew nothing about it. And I would arrange the room so it's just right, get myself ready, play my pieces and cross my fingers. There were never ever people from Montenegro at the Royal Academy of Music, at least I don't know of any. And to go there was such a big thing, and actually it was such a big thing for my country. And I remember before I went for London, it was in all the media and all the papers, because at that point I was quite well known in Montenegro for what I was doing. It was tough. I was so homesick. I was really so homesick, and I was younger than everybody else. On the very first day in the Academy, my teacher, Michael Lewin, who I adore, found me crying because I knew nothing they were talking about. But I found refuge in music because I knew I had to change a lot of things. I knew I had to learn how to play. I knew that I have to obtain the tools to make the music which I had inside myself. I graduated in 2004 and from my master's in 2006. And then for 2 years, I was very lucky. I stayed in the Academy as a junior fellow. And what was very significant for me at that time was that it was a wonderful cushion from the outside world, because it's always a shock when you leave the Academy, when you leave a place where you train, and you are immediately kind of left alone into the world.
I think that for people who are going to go on to be musicians, there might be pressure from their family, there might be pressure from society, there's a need to make money, those kinds of things. But in their heart, there's only one path. So there's really no pressure. If anything, it's completely liberating. You have to do that thing. It's a vocation, and you've been called to it.
I applied for one audition, which was supposed to give me a shared recital at the Wigmore Hall. And I remember how much I was preparing for it and in what great shape I was. And I played really well. And I got a letter saying that, please come back next year. We really love how you play, but you are not quite ready. And that made me really, really angry. And I was like, but why do you think I'm not ready? Because I thought I was ready.
The point about the Wigmore Hall is that it is the mecca of chamber music the world over. All classical musicians, all chamber players, they all want to appear at the Wigmore, and until they have, they don't feel they've really arrived. So if you give a debut at the Wigmore Hall, that's your real arrival.
When I performed the debut concert at the Wigmore Hall, that was a very special moment because I won against all the hardship which I had to experience in order to get into the career and into the profession.
Well, he came across as, you know, rather shy and very modest and just terribly good.
The audience reacted very, very well to him.
It was the moment when I completely relaxed about what I do and how I do it, and just the moment when I embraced it for what it is. And that was a big liberation, feeling of liberation.
I first heard Milos on CD. I thought, that's clever, I thought, you know, brilliant how he's managed to do two tracks and obviously played with himself and accompanied himself with, you know, with harmonies and everything. I thought, brilliant, fantastic, well, marvellous. And then I went to a concert and I realised it wasn't that at all. He was doing everything at the same time. And I thought, I'd never heard the guitar played like that ever.
For my very first CD, the choice of repertoire was very difficult because I wanted to do everything on that CD. But because it was my first CD, I thought that probably the best and the most natural way would be to start from the repertoire which inspired me to be a classical guitarist in the first place. My first connection with this instrument was through Albéniz, Starega, Granados, all of these composers. So I said, let's start from the beginning. Let's start with the pieces which marked my journey, which marked my first concert, my arrival to London, things like this. So that's how Mediterranean was born, as a very personal landscape. I always view a CD as a painting. It's like a painter does this painting over a course of a period of time, and it just puts all the different influences onto that painting, and then in the end it is within this frame and it's this one beautiful thing. I always observe CDs in the same way. If you told me 3 years ago I would be playing here, I would have given my all just to play one note.
Me of a duck skimming along the surface of water. It's just gliding. There's no work at all. And then underneath, and you know Milos's fingers are working so hard to make that sound happen. But the sound is, it's light as air.
When I was recording Latino, I just allowed myself to take a plunge into this music and to just simply enjoy every single note and every single moment of it. And I would say that the Latin music, derived from tango, samba, from all of those styles and areas, into the classical pieces by Villa-Lobos, by Barrios, by Ponce, in a way they are more free. I was allowing myself to really take a deep breath and to just allow for this music to happen in the space of time. When it comes to the Albert Hall, it really is one of the biggest dreams which I ever had. The first time when I saw what Albert Hall was on TV in Montenegro. And it was some kind of a big gala concert with a lot of different players, and I was just thinking, wow, can you imagine the feeling of performing in this space? And when I got to London, one of the first visits which I made was to visit the Albert Hall, and when I saw it, I said, I have to get to play here one day.
Really is the new big figure in the apostolic succession, which began with Segovia, went on through Julian Bream, continued through John Williams. I think Milos is aware of this. He's not arrogant about it, but he knows that he is, in fact, the new ambassador for the guitar. And frankly, we couldn't have a better one.
One of the reasons I'd like to one day work with him, if it was ever a possibility, is when you've got somebody who's obviously experimenting and trying things out and taking the instrument to a place that it's never been taken to before, perhaps, I get very excited.
Completely focused on his music, but a real missionary to spread the word that the classical guitar is something worth listening to.
Milos is perfectly positioned to take this instrument and this new music forward, not only because he's such a great player, so sensitive, but I think because he understands the potential of communicating with an audience with that guitar.
Play with me. That's, you know, we should definitely work on that.
Rory and Will continue their mission to win the title Champions of the World next today, and their camper van heads to the south of England.